Welcome. Welcome to a celebration and a mourning. Celebration for what courageous, justice-minded people did as they marched from Selma to Montgomery. Mourning for what is yet to be done. Celebration for what courageous, justice-minded people have done in Ferguson, in New York, and in many points throughout the U.S. and throughout the world. Mourning for what is yet to be done. We have three panelists tonight who will be introduced to you by our host, and so I simply welcome you to this event and introduce our host, Walter Fluker, the Martin Luther King Jr. Professor of Ethical Leadership. Walter Fluker not only carries that title, but he carries that spirit. And so he will lead us through a very important discussion this afternoon. Thank you and welcome.
Thank you, Dean Mary Elizabeth Moore. Let's give our dean a round of applause. The theologian Sally McVeigh says, of friends, our friends say to one another, I'm glad you exist. Let's get started. Listen to this. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtapositioning us. Justice for all just ain't specific enough. One son died, his spirit is revisiting us. True and living, living in us, resistance is us. That's why Rosa sat on the bus. That's why we walked through Ferguson with our hands up. When it go down, we woman and man up. They say stay down and we stand up. Shots, we on the ground, the camera panned up. King pointed to the mountaintop and we ran up. One day when the glory comes, it will be ours. It will be ours. One day, when the war is won, we will be sure. We will be sure. Oh, glory. Oh, glory. These are lyrics from Glory, the theme song from the movie Selma. The song makes the critical linkage between Selma 50 years ago and today. So we're delighted to present this panel in commemoration of Selma and the 50th year anniversary of the Voting Rights Act, and to extend the movement to the challenges associated with Ferguson, Missouri, Staten Island, New York, and let us not forget Sanford, Florida, and so many other places around the country where human beings can't breathe and not allowed to live even when their hands are up. Made possible by the generous support of the Lowell Institute, Selma at 50, Ferguson Today, as the panel was called, is a conversation with School of Theology alumni who were on the front lines at Selma in 1965 and activists who are on the front lines today. After the panel, we invite everyone to attend the 6:30 concert in Marsh Chapel featuring Mark Miller and the Seminary Singers. And I've been warned and forewarned that you need to fill this out. Does everybody have one? If you don't have one, it's kind of like a ticket to heaven, salvation. Each panelist this evening will have 12 to 15 minutes to speak, and then we will offer them some time for exchange among themselves. And then there will be a brief question and answer session from the audience. I'm going to ask that we proceed in the following order as requested by the panelists. The Reverend Dr. William Bobby McClain, alumnus 62 and 77, MDiv and DMin. is professor of preaching and worship at Wesley Theological Seminary in Washington, D.C., former senior pastor at Union United Methodist Church here in Boston. And in 1981, he began as professor of preaching and worship at Wesley Theological Seminary, where in 1999, he was named the Mary Elizabeth McGee Joyce Chair in Preaching and Worship, the first fully endowed chair in the seminary's history. Dr. McClain conceived of and chaired the committee which produced the hymn book. He autographed one already this evening. Songs of Zion, Zion Still Sings for Every Generation. He wrote Come Sunday, a liturgical companion to Songs of Zion and other celebrated writings. Dr. Don Messer, 66 and 69, is currently the executive director at the Center for the Church and Global AIDS. Dr. Messer was president of Dakota Wesleyan University for 10 years, 1971 through 1981, and president of the Isle of School of Theology in Denver, Colorado, for 19 years, 1981 to 2000. He also served as the Henry White Warren Professor of Practical Theology at Isle of School of Theology from 1981 to 2006. He is the author of 15 books, including Names, Not Just Numbers, Facing Global AIDS and World Hunger, 52 Ways to Create an AIDS-Free World, Cherishing Life and Love, Reflections of Paul Murphy, Ending Hunger Now, A Challenge to Persons of Faith, and so on. If BU did not graduate another person, it would have justified its existence because of these two men.
Whoa.
It makes you so proud when you're a fellow alum. We really are a tradition. Pamela Lightsey is the Boston University School of Theology Associate Dean for Community Life and Lifelong Learning and Clinical Assistant Professor of Contextual Theology and Practice. Dr. Lightsey is a scholar, a social justice activist, and military veteran whose academic and research interests include classical and contemporary just war theory, womanist theology, queer theory and theology, and African-American religious history and theologies. An ordained elder in the Northern Illinois Conference of the United Methodist Church, Pamela pastored an urban church on the south side of Chicago, has done work for several UM general agencies, and has strong connections within several mainline denominations. Pamela's publications include Reconciliation in Radical Evangelical, and If There Should Come a Word in Black United Methodist Preach. I'm so happy to serve as a colleague with a person like Pamela, who not only talks the talk, but walks the walk. This is our panel for this evening, and I'm gonna invite our good friend, William Bobby McClain. Again.
Thank you. I have entitled my remarks, Why I Went to Selma and Led Others to Go 50 Years Ago. I was born in Gadsden, Alabama, in Etowah County, about 150 miles north of Selma, Alabama. Gadsden is located in the northeast corner of Alabama in the foothills of Lookout Mountain, right where the mighty and muddy, often muddy, Mississippi Coosa River passes through and makes its way and turns south to go south to head through Birmingham and Tuscaloosa and Montgomery, to pour its contents into the immense and marvelous Mississippi River to flow to the Gulf of Mexico. From grade 6 through graduation in 1956, I attended the racially segregated Carver High School. the first public school built and named after the great scientist George Washington Carver of Tuskegee Institute of Tuskegee, Alabama. There at Carver High School were some of the brightest and most talented teachers who had been recruited in 1936 from all over the United States to honor this great scientist and to build a model school for black education in Alabama, for the South and the nation. As a young precocious student, I studied American history, civics, government, Negro history, Alabama history. My teachers stressed the importance of the founding of America as a democracy and a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. They taught us the significance of the passing and the ratification of the Reconstruction Amendments to the Constitution of the United States of America. The 13th Amendment of the outlawing slavery and involuntary servitude. The 14th Amendment granting citizenship to all persons born or naturalized in the United States. And the 15th Amendment that prohibits the states of the federal government from using a citizen's race, color, or previous status as a slave to be a voting qualification. And yet, none of our wonderful, educated, talented teachers, our marvelous mentors and models, could register to vote. Couldn't exercise that responsible citizenship and to model for us in the community that remarkable freedom they taught us about in the classroom. Even though they were upright, responsible, law-abiding citizens, and educated ones at that. As a matter of fact, one of my high school teachers had a master's degree from Boston University. Think of that, even in those days. But he could not vote because of the color of his skin. It always seemed to me a contradiction. Was it a trick they were playing on us and our young developing minds? Was this a genuine romance with America and its principles of freedom and democracy and citizenship with unrequited love? Or was this merely a sordid affair in which loyalty and faithfulness and meant nothing, their fidelity to the nation spurned, their true feelings of love of country wantonly unappreciated and unreciprocated, and where nothing in return was to be expected? From the earliest days that I can remember, racial segregation made no sense to me. And white supremacy was a clear and indisputable contradiction in terms. It did not seem to square with what those teachers said at school. It did not reach the level of logic with the books I read. It was not consistent with what I heard from the Bible and the pulpit of our church. And that was especially puzzling and troubling to me because our family were Methodists, a part of the founding of Sweet Home Methodist Episcopal Church, almost 5 miles from our house. And my family boasted about being a part of the Methodist Episcopal Church North. And I could not quite understand why we did not ever go in the Methodist Church in North Gadsden, where we lived. And I could have thrown a rock from our front porch and hit the steeple of North Gadsden Methodist Church. And yet, we never went in North Gadsden Methodist Church. Why? It was a white Methodist church. Now our house is gone, and that church is gone too. I was to learn to understand it better by and by. After I finished seminary here at Boston University School of Theology in 1962, I returned to that segregated Alabama and a segregated church to be the pastor of Haven Chapel Methodist Episcopal Church in Anniston, Alabama, where the Freedom Bus had been burned earlier. I also helped to found and organize the Calhoun County Improvement Association to fight segregation, and I became its first executive secretary. One of the achievements of that organization was to bring Martin Luther King to Anniston as a part of our protest of segregation in lunch counters, schools, buses, and bus stations, train stations, waiting rooms, public restrooms, and other public facilities. Fearing the violence that might happen, even though we were fiercely and faithfully committed to nonviolence, the mayor of the city of Anniston, at the urging of us and a white Presbyterian pastor named J. Phillips Noble, appointed a 9-member biracial human relations council in 1963 to begin the orderly desegregation process of the city. I was one of the 5 African Americans appointed to this human relations council. After long and heated discussion in which the black members argued for total desegregation, the council agreed that desegregating the public library was the safest place to begin. So September the 15th, 1963 was chosen as the date. The agreement was that it would be done quietly and secretively. That day came. It also came to Birmingham, Alabama, in the 16th Street Baptist Church, where the Ku Klux Klan bombing that morning had killed those 4 little girls as they left Sunday school in the basement of the church on their way to upstairs for a morning worship led by the youth. As Nimrod Reynolds, the pastor of 17th Street Baptist Church, my friend and colleague and president of the Calhoun County Improvement Association, headed to that library that Sunday afternoon, we were in grief about what had happened in Birmingham that morning. Little did we expect that we would be attacked by a mob of the Klan, estimated at 100 people, who assaulted and beat us as we attempted to enter the library to begin the desegregation process in Anniston, Alabama. I had just returned from Boston University from that Anniston, Alabama in the fall of 1963, to begin work on a PhD degree in systematic theology. But in the spring, the Selma campaign for voting rights reached a feverish pitch after the Reverend James Reeb from Boston was killed by the Ku Klux Klan in Selma. Dr. King, SCLC, the Massachusetts Council of Churches, the National Council of Churches, called on clergy to go to Selma en masse to support the campaign for voting rights. I felt strongly that I ought to go back to Gadsden, Alabama, to Anniston, Alabama, to Selma, Alabama, and take as many seminarians as possible. Don Messer and several other students from this School of Theology, along with students from Andover Newton and Harvard and the Episcopal Theological Seminary, joined us in 2 busloads as we headed to Alabama to make our witness, to take our stand, and to risk our lives for freedom in the name and for the sake of the gospel. As we neared Selma and the place of battle, our troops became more frightened and fearful of what might happen. I was scared too, but I was encouraged to arrange for us to have a prayer meeting in Atlanta. So we stopped at our sister institution, Gammon Theological Seminary on Beckwith Street in Atlanta. And there we sang and prayed as we prepared to go to Selma to meet at Brown Chapel, African Methodist Episcopal Church, a former Methodist church, and to join our fellow Boston University alumnus, Dr. Martin Luther King, and the Selma Voter Rights Movement of Dallas County. Prayerfully and with trepidation, and with some fear and trembling, we prepared ourselves to meet Sheriff Jim Clark and his 200 deputies, many who were simply members of the Ku Klux Klan and the White Citizens Council, who had been deputized overnight by Sheriff Clark. We prepared to meet the police chief, Wilson Baker, and Mayor Joseph Smith. We expected to cross that Edmund Pettus Bridge and transform a place of infamy into a hallowed place of memory. In the words of Hebrew scripture, a gehul. So that in years to come, when our children ask us, what does such a place mean? We should be able to tell them that the Lord helped us to cross that bridge.
Thank you, Bob. Where do I begin in addressing the topic of Selma at 50 Ferguson today? Do I start by outlining the historical context that prompted 83 seminary students 50 years ago to hire buses and become freedom riders to Selma, Alabama? Or do I begin by describing the unique role that Boston University School of Theology faculty, students, and graduates played in the struggle for civil rights in the United States? Possibly I should commence by talking how this historical experience shaped a generation of theological students, pastors, spouses, and leaders. Or perhaps I should initiate this lecture by focusing on the not on the past, but by attempting to draw parallels between Selma yesterday and Ferguson today. But no, I think I should begin with the root cause of Selma at 50 and Ferguson today, namely the evil reality of white racism, conscious and unconscious, manifest and latent in America. As much as I continue to hope that we'll move beyond the presumptuousness of white privilege and bigotry, its ugly face continues to permeate American society. As FBI Director James Comey candidly acknowledges, racial bias and disparities, low employment rates and poverty influence racial disparities in arrests, incarcerations, and unjustified law enforcement killings. Whether it was yesterday in Selma or today in Ferguson, Cleveland, Staten Island, Denver, or Miami, we still live with both the remnants of historical racial bias and the reality of contemporary racial prejudice and fear, often disguised, but too easily evidenced in the actions of police profiling and our quick white defense of almost every instance of white officers gunning down black youth in our streets. The 1917 words of James Weldon Johnson still echo the truth. The race question involves the saving of black America's body and white America's soul. When I reflect on my journey to Selma some 50 years ago, my most painful personal memory is not the fear that Bob described as we headed through the dark and dangerous roads of Georgia and Alabama, even though my friend Bob McClain has been known to say that if Don looks white tonight, you should have seen how pale he was when he entered Alabama. No, my most personal painful memory is not the faces of the angry and bewildered people who lined the streets of Selma where we marched. My personal pain still lingers on a phone call that I made to my parents halfway to Selma. I've been growing up in rural South Dakota in a Christian home with exceptionally supportive parents who had encouraged my college and seminary education, helped me spend my junior year abroad in India. I had anticipated my parents would be fearful for my safety and concerned that I had left my new bride, Bonnie, in Boston. But what I wasn't prepared for was to hear their disapproval of my demonstrating with that agitator, Martin Luther King, in Selma, and possibly risking arrest. 50 years later, the words of my father still haunt me. If you get arrested, don't call us to bail you out. Like lightning, those words ignited in me an awareness that racism did not only exist in America's Deep South, but was a reality across the nation, even in the hearts and minds of my most beloved family. The ethos of racial superiority lurked in unexpected places and people. Naively and idealistically, I joined in the struggle for equality for all Americans, not realizing the depth that racism had impregnated white society
even my own family. With the election of President Barack Obama, I once again idealistically hope that America might be post-racial and embrace the we shall overcome theology and ethics that I had encountered at Boston University School of Theology. But in the intervening years since 2008, I have come to believe that much of the political criticism and opposition that our president has faced has come from a deep-seated racism that cannot accept the visionary leadership of a black president.
That's right.
Yes, racism has always been a major cause and consequence for America's slow progress toward justice and equality for all. But also racism in ourselves, our family, our society, our church, has been a starting point for many of us as we've sought to express our Christian beliefs in ethical behavior. By reconciling word and deed, we have committed ourselves to standing with the marginalized and mistreated, and to be partners with persons striving for justice, equality, and human rights. The civil rights of the 1960s were, for my generation, the entry point for a lifetime of pursuing human rights for all people everywhere. So let me get back to 1965, and quickly, if I can, sketch out what prompted 83 seminarians, exactly 42 from Boston University School of Theology, 23 from Andover Newton, 3 from ETS, and 4 from Harvard, and maybe I have a few spouses that I didn't have in that 83, to head out on a week's journey to Selma in 2 buses and 2 cars. Often forgotten is that there were also 15 other Boston University student seminarians who went to Washington, D.C. during the same time to lobby Congress for voting rights legislation. Elliot Richardson had just returned from Selma. He was the lieutenant governor at the time. He reported that Selma was a tranquil, but with a residue of terror. Each student who went, paid $40 for their bus ticket, then equivalent to a month's rent for housing. And others in the seminary made charitable donations to assist. I happened to have been chosen treasurer and fundraiser for the trip, and because I have a tendency never to throw anything away, I've kept the records of the trip, and we now know exactly who went and how much each person contributed and paid. I pass that information on to Dean Elizabeth Ford. Everyone participating has their own memories, and since almost all of us are preachers, we tend to be engaged in some hyperbole. Also, 50 years is a long time ago, and historical accuracy is not always an achievable goal for persons our age. But I recount as best I can using the records. In recollecting and remembering Selma, we have to be aware of our temptation to hype the event or have our own Brian Williams moments. Particularly puzzling to me in recent days is when I read accounts of my colleagues who went on this Boston University of Selma journey to see how my colleagues have remembered the event differently. My own notes from the time talk about the quiet fear and tension of the white people who watched our march, while some of my other colleague participants report on hostile, angry, shouting bystanders. I don't know, but maybe different things happened at different times along the marchway, or memories of other marches have merged with their experiences, but we do have different memories. Bob and I would like to paint a heroic portrait of ourselves on this seminary march as having faced menacing dogs and club-wielding troopers, because that would make this speech a lot more interesting and a lot less truthful. That doesn't mean that we weren't scared or that danger didn't lurk at unexpected places. Remember, Boston University School of Theology was not a neutral observer in the struggle for civil rights. Ahead of its time, this school had its own affirmative action program recruiting outstanding African American students. Martin Luther King, a Boston University alumnus, was, as we know, at the forefront of the civil rights revolution. Led by Dean Walter Mueller, theology professor Harold DeWolf, the seminary faculty was totally supportive of the nonviolent civil disobedience and justice efforts of Dr. King. By the time I entered this seminary, the school had long embraced the unofficial logo of being the School of the Prophets. Keith Watson, in an essay entitled In the Shadows of Segregation, Methodist Seminaries and the Civil Rights Movement, tells how Perkins School of Theology finally became integrated in 1952, 13 years before Candler School of Theology at Emory University was integrated. Bill Caldwell was denied admission to Duke in 1955 because he was an African American. Even after Perkins was integrated, the rest of Southern Methodist University remained segregated. In contrast, Boston University School of Theology was championing the civil rights movement. Now, remember, our emphasis on equality had its limits. Women were not allowed to participate in the seminary singers, even as guest soloists. That won't be true tonight. Most of us, whether we publicly said so or not, did not champion women as clergy. I only had one class taught by a woman faculty member in my 6 years of MDiv and PhD studies. Never discussed in my memory was the fact that lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender persons faced incredible discrimination and injustice. Yes, we had our blind spots as well. Even as I prepared this lecture, I realized that had I told you just from my memory, I would have told you there were no women students with us. But in looking at the record, I discovered 10 or 12 accompanying us to Selma. That's how our blinders were off. After Bloody Sunday on March 7th, a group of us gathered at Boston University to discuss how we could help improve race relations. Our initial purpose was to improve them within the School of Theology. Fairly quickly, we decided, at Bob's urging, we needed to go to Selma, and we responded accordingly. And therefore, we had fundraising committees and efforts to do so. Many of the people who were involved have continued to lead strong lives of active involvement. We responded and we raised funds. Every student was transformed in some significant way. According to my records, we raised $742.14 in gifts. In 1965, that had the same buying power as $5,585 today. King's Major Professor led the way with the largest donation. Seminary singers contributed $75. All the faculty contributed, and we'd see their names like Harold DeWolf, Walter Mulder, Earl Kent Brown, Sam Hedrick, Richard Ward, Donald Maynard, Paul Schilling, Clifford Moore. Many of us went to Selma in that trip. It took 2.5 days to get there, and we were there for 2.5 days. It was the testimony and preaching of Gil Caldwell and Bobby McClain that had a profound impact on us. We went to join the efforts. When we got there, we discovered the march that we thought we were going to had been postponed. We had just gotten federal approval, so we didn't actually make the march from Montgomery to Selma, but we marched every day, 2 of the 3 days we were in Selma. According to my notes, the people were not so angry at us as they were bewildered by our presence. Thankfully, the trip was uneventful. We did not face any of the angry mobs, but we did have an inspiring experience. I saved a copy of the Selma Times Journal, which I brought along with me today, which shows on the front page of the time we were there that the women had had a successful flower show the day before. That the judge had ruled that there is a federal march was possible, and a big headline that said, "Churchmen deplore demonstration." And in it, it says how the Archbishop had denounced the Catholic nuns and priests, and how Billy James Hargis had called the rest of us communist clergy agitators for coming. So I'll turn this over to Dean Moore as well. All of this is to remind us that this was a tense time in our history. The editorial pages denounced our coming. One woman wrote, "I have colored people working for me now who have been with me for years. If that hellion M.L. King ever moves on with his nuns and mongrelizers, things will get back to normal and we'll once again have the same lovely city." And so it was as we entered Selma. As we marched there, we were welcomed by Clifford Moore, professor from the school, along with Harvey Cox. Reverend C.T. Vivian told us this was a campaign of radical love versus radical evil. He challenged us to put our fresh, warm bodies behind our strong convictions. Or as Professor Fluker recently reminded us all, true commitment means putting some flesh on the line. and that's been the story of the History Light movement. From my rural roots in South Dakota, that time was like a foretaste of the kingdom of heaven, as we marched together in great diversity and change. To quote Rabbi Abraham Heschel, it was a political and secular, but also a religious act. He said marching was about protest and prayer. Legs are not lips, and walking's not healing, and yet our legs uttered songs. Even without words, our march was worship. I felt my legs were praying. And so we were in Selma, and so we left Selma. Disappointed we hadn't participated in the great march, feeling maybe we hadn't really sacrificed like we should have. But we left committed in our own ways to be champions of equality, justice, and human rights for African Americans, Latinos, other racial minorities, women, and the LGBT community. We may have faltered and failed. We may not always have been as bold and courageous as we should have been the past 50 years. And we may not have always been the leaders we were called by God to be. But Selma transformed us and continues to challenge us. Thus, we resonated to the 2012 inaugural words of our President, Barack Obama, when he said, "We the people declare today that the most evident of truths, that all of us are created equal, is a star that guided us still, just as it guided our forebears through Seneca Falls and Selma and Stonewall, just as it guided all those men and women, sung and unsung, who left footprints along this great mall. To hear a preacher say, we cannot walk alone. To hear a king proclaim that our individual freedom is inextricably bound to the freedom of every soul on earth. So our commitment for human rights, justice, and equality for all people must be continued. Thank you."
Bloody Sunday, when Alabama state troopers attacked protesters on Edmund Pettus Bridge. The images taken during the first 21 days of protests in Ferguson, Missouri, are some of the most iconic in our nation's history. Seeing these images shared and stirred within me the desire to travel to Ferguson to lend my hand and my scholarship to the movement. I'm a child of the Black Power movement. As a child of that movement, I and my peers critiqued what we felt was the witness and the weakness of the nonviolence of Dr. King. We felt that that weakness was the unwillingness to defend oneself against violence. Stokely Carmichael, during those days, said that violence is as American as apple pie. Later, my perspective about nonviolence would change as I would become a member of the United States Army and be trained to do battle. My son served in Iraq during the first days of shock and awe, and his unit followed behind a Patriot missile unit while I was writing my dissertation entitled, "If Somebody Hits You, Towards a Pan-African Perspective of Just War." Years later, influenced by Gil Caldwell's solidarity within the lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender movement, Gil Caldwell, my brother, my older brother from another mother, has worked with me and helped me to see the intersections of oppressions. Now, some have asked how the killing of one Black man in Ferguson ignited such a tumultuous turn of events. Frankly, I feel that question is inaccurate. Black citizens in Ferguson and many other cities have been bearing an internal rage kindled by poverty and discrimination for quite some time. Demands are being made, even as some question whether justice can be fully recognized. Let me show you a portion of a clip.
The light's down.
can hear. No sound.
See whether or not black people are disproportionately stopped on the streets and the highways of Missouri. And every year for at least 10 years that has been proven to be the case. So we're calling upon Eric Holder, along with Eric Holder, the federal general attorney, attorney general, that is, as well as the state attorney, to take some actions to correct that and address those municipalities.
But what does justice look like? Are you thinking about Joe?
What does justice look like? Yeah.
And throwing stuff. Yeah. Be careful.
It is the injustice of a city making nearly $3 million in annual revenue by disproportionately fining black motorists that stoked the flame of rage. Debtors' prisons, police harassment, and the niggerization of black people under the heels of a systemic institutionalized racism is what has caused black people and our allies to rise up and in this 21st century to say black lives matter. It's more than a hashtag movement. It is an insistence upon justice. I went to Ferguson during the first 21 days of the protests and continued to travel to Ferguson. Most recently, I shot footage the night the grand jury decision not to indict was announced. In a very surreal moment, the protesters that day following the announcement marched to the bridge named after Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. That bridge led to Highway I-44. And as we were approaching the bridge, I could help but think of Selma. With the sounds of police sirens approaching, I, like many other protesters, including one school of theology student named Colin Cushman, had to make the quick decision whether we would indeed continue our march and our intention to exercise civil disobedience by shutting down the highway. As police in riot gear advanced upon protesters, we made this decision. And as the protesters were pepper sprayed, I thought to myself, not much has changed. That evening near the police station, tear gas was launched at us without ample warning. And as many of you have read, some police officers still hurl bigoted insults at those who have the courage to stand up to discrimination. And I'm going to show you some of that footage shortly. Finally, you know, I want to say about the footage that you'll see on some of the footage that I show you that we stood at a particular place at a moment in time that did not go past me. We were standing on the steps of the St. Louis Old Courthouse. Now, some of you will know the significance of St. Louis's Old Courthouse. It's still relevant, and it's quite relevant to this year's 50-year anniversary of the Voting Rights Act. And during the footage that I want to show you, I want you to pay attention to what is being chanted. I hope that you can hear it. And I want you to pay attention to the radical use of patriotic language and the lifting up of an ancestral hero. The latter, the lifting up of this ancestral hero, is what made me weep as a baby. So let me try to show you the clip.
Lord, that's your gift. That's your gift.
Did everyone gathered there know of Dred Scott? Did they know that we were standing on the very steps of the site where his case, his lawsuit for his and his family was heard and denied? Do you know who Dred Scott was? I listened to young folks whispering the question around me. Who is Dred Scott? And that suggested to me that we've got a whole lot of teaching left to do. In 2013, the Voting Rights Act was gutted. And when the Supreme Court of the United States decided to remove Section 4, I was just floored by that, particularly as I was working in Ferguson and understanding the impact of the gutting of the Voting Rights Act. I want to end my remarks today by drawing attention to that Voting Rights Act because I believe that the connection can and should be made from Dred Scott to Selma to Ferguson. Black people in the United States have brought their demands before the legislative processes of our country. We must continue to push for justice through public policy, and I believe it is the work of activists then and now to see it to fruition. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lightsey, Reverend McClain, and Don Nesser. I sat here and I said to myself, isn't it amazing the ways in which, and I mentioned this to a class this morning, in which our memory is fluid.
memory is not hard and stiff. It's more like a river. It flows in and out. And some of the symbolism that you've all evoked really is part of what I think we need to begin this conversation with. And you can take it where you want to. Pamela raises the case of Dred Scott, which ruled that a Negro has no rights that a white person should respect, right? And the idea that the humanity of black people or people of African descent, only 3/5 in terms of quantifiable data and value that allows us to make decisions. Now, if you're at the old Missouri St. Louis courthouse, that becomes even more significant because this is also a site of memory. Now, I'm most interested in how we translate memory into action and ways in which it shows up on the ground. Those of us who are Christians, we love language of incarnation. And Don mentioned that I really think incarnation is always about flesh in the game. How do we begin to make that connection, these linkages between this long past, our memories of 50 years ago, and really what's going on? The first ethical question H. Richard Niebuhr always asked was, what's going on? And when we contextualize, then we got to ask questions about how memory is also related to what's going on. That's a theological professor's question, but I do think you follow me, right?
Well, I think the young people in Ferguson standing on the steps, those who were chanting from Dred Scott to Mike Brown, were making use of memory, and they were seeing it rather poignantly standing on those steps. As a matter of fact, they actually pushed down as an act of civil disobedience the guardrail to the steps of the courthouse, and the police came because they thought we were going to rush the courthouse, but they said it rather aggressively, we remember what took place at this site. Not all the protesters remember it, but certainly the leaders of the chant remembered it and were in their own way passing that on to the other protesters to influence at least those who didn't know Dred Scott to ask the question and to learn right there on the spot. So I think that was one of the ways that it's being done even now.
I think the church has to be involved in dealing with these issues. And white churches are going to have to stop being simply places where it is simply safe for white people. It's got to become a place where it is safe for people across racial lines, across gender lines, across gender-specific lines, to have the conversation. I said to a class, Dr. Dean Moore's class this afternoon, we've got to have that conversation where we are able to say to each other in each other's presence what we say about each other in each other's absence. Part of the problem, even in Selma and in Ferguson, those policemen don't understand and know the people whom they're dealing with. There's been no communication. There's been no honesty. There's been no establishment of community. There's been no communication and honest communication between the police. So part of what the church can seem to be provide is a safe place, and we have to have a safe place where honest conversation can take place. I saw a clip the other day of a United Methodist Church, and where was it? Green, did y'all see that Green Street in North Carolina? A church that has taken that step, a white Methodist church in North Carolina, taking the step to provide that kind of safe place where conversation takes place.
Winston-Salem.
Go online and check that out. Check out where the church and how the church can actually be involved. Let's not keep talking about what somebody else can do. Let's talk about what we can do as Christians, as members of the Church of Jesus Christ.
My late colleague, brother, friend, Vince Harding, used to refer to those involved in the civil rights movement as veterans of hope. I look at this audience, I see a lot of veterans of hope.
Yes.
And I think we have a, Dr. Harding used to be especially concerned about how we're going to share the memories and the historical information to future generations. We do have an obligation as veterans of hope, all of us, to find ways to communicate in our own churches, families, communities, public schools, this history, to see how it connects with the contemporary life, because things have changed, but some things have not changed, and we have to continue not to think that we are have reached that point where change is not needed, but actually we're at a critical moment in which we need to mobilize our memory and our forces, our veterans of hope, to move forward.
Are there any other exchanges you want to make before I open the door?
This is it.
Okay, good. Let's begin with the audience, and I think the easiest way to do this is to let me know maybe three people who are going to have questions or comments so that they can kind of take notes. The mind does not move as quickly as the eyes do. And if we could have three people who have questions or comments, I'll be glad to take three at a time.
My question is, and yes, I understand we need to have the conversations, but how do we, as people of color, have these conversations without frustration and anger, tempest flaring, coming into play? I find it very hard watching the clips, going to see the movie Selma, going to see the movie The Butler, those types of things, they leave me very angry. How can we come together with these conversations and rid ourselves of the anger?
Very important question. Is there another? Or a statement, you can also make comments.
I'll just say that I'm appreciative of the panel and the audience, but I'm just disappointed there aren't more young people, because that's the challenge now, is how would we pass this on to the young people so they don't repeat our mistakes, so that they learn from their history. That's the challenge. That's one of the reasons I'm here, trying to pass it on to the youth of my church, my sons, to make the difference, to change them.
So why aren't the youth here? Not referencing Julian Cook and a few people, but the majority.
Yes.
Okay. Anyone else? All the way in the back.
Hello, thank you. I guess my question is, what's the best way to have conversations when we feel like, I had a conversation yesterday, and you want to have an open conversation about how justice is not here in all ways, and people who have been oppressed continue to oppress other people in different ways, if that makes sense. So my conversation was with someone about LGBT in the church, someone who is black and so has been oppressed in different ways, but then, you know, said, I've been taught this is a sin. And, you know, so it's okay to oppress. Do you get what I'm saying? Not so eloquently.
Why do oppressed people oppress other people? For different reasons, right. Maybe, but it's still oppression.
And how do we address that type of oppression, because we want to
I would love to address the latter, because I'm a woman of several contexts. I am black, and as you can see, woman. But I'm also a queer lesbian woman. So part of the reason I did go down to Ferguson is also had in my mind, where's the presence of black LGBTQ persons in the movement? And I was very happy to see that several of the leaders of the movement are black, queer women, black gay men, and they're really being very intentional in the hashtag movement that says Black Lives Matter, to reframe it of sorts and to say all Black Lives Matter, including members of the Black LGBTQ community. So you're quite correct that there within, and I think within every culture, you have the oppression, you have a subset of persons who oppress oppressed persons. And how do you go about having those conversations is important, and the way you go about having those conversations as an ally is to know how you enter, to be aware of your context when you enter into that conversation. Check your privilege, be aware of your privilege when you enter into those conversations. And try not to lead those conversations to the end that you assume they should go. And that will require some education on the parts of our allies who are not LGBTQ, but really want to be in solidarity with the movement.
Dr. Nasser?
Well, I don't think I can answer some of those questions. I don't think I hear and feel the question about how people of color have conversations with the anger. I don't think I'm qualified to answer that question. I can appreciate it. But I would speak out for the seminary students who may not be here tonight, but Dr. McClain and I have spent the day really in a lot of conversation with students, and I must say we're both extremely impressed by the students, current students, and their sense of justice and equality. And they're dealing with more issues than we did in our day. A whole range of issues of justice and equality, whether it's race, immigration issues, LGBTQ issues, all of those. And I think there's this school is generating a lot of interest and involvement. We do have a broader issue in the society, but I think things like that we need to keep supporting are like Black History Month. To be real candid, the other night we were moving to Delaware, and our granddaughter was educating us about some things in Black history that my wife and I didn't know, but she'd learned at her third grade class. So it makes a difference. And sometimes we can despair, but actually we just need to keep pressing on.
I come back to the church again. I think that the church has a responsibility to aid in the education of people in terms of history, in terms of Black history, in terms of, and to see Black history as a part of American history. Yeah. My goodness, what has happened here? You can't even talk about American history without talking about slavery, about Black people, about the presence of Black people in America. Cynthia, I heard your question about anger. Anger is a genuine emotion. Anybody who claims that they don't ever get angry is not human. And there's plenty to be angry about. We need to be clear about that. You know, and I get concerned when Christians, you know the Christians, are so afraid to express emotion that somehow we don't have feeling. We dare not express. We dare not engage in conflict. We dare not express anger. Don't get loud. Well, the truth is, if you're human, you do get angry. And there are things to be angry about. Every time I see the clips of those white policemen killing these Black boys, I get angry. All over again. Unarmed, helpless in some cases, and simply being shot down like dogs on the highway. I get angry, and I won't express that anger. But I want to use the anger as energy to do something about what I'm angry about.
And two things, you know, it's not anger that's the problem. It's discrimination that's the problem. And we need to be aware of that, and we need to hold the anger and move with it and make it useful. Do something with it. Do something with it. And channel our rage into resources to ending bigotry. And if you're serious about ending bigotry, well, then you should be serious about ending bigotry for black people within all contexts. It's not, it bothers me that black people get angry about the bigotry of racism and don't get angry about the bigotry of homophobia. I didn't suck, you know, I didn't go down to Ferguson and do the work that I did to come back and be told to take a back seat because I'm a queer lesbian woman. No. I get, you know, that angers me, and I will not allow it in my life.
I think we're moving with something. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much. I so appreciate your question.
You need to talk a little louder.
Oh, I'm sorry. I so appreciate the question about how to have these conversations with that rage. And not just how to work with that rage, but how to converse through that rage. And I think part of that is on the responsibility of white allies. And a lot of this is so, there's a reason there's a trope of the angry black person, right? Black people didn't make that trope up, white people did. Because we are unsure of what to do with that anger. And I think a lot of it is being able to be comfortable witnessing that and being able to stand with our black siblings in that rage, to feel that rage ourselves, and to just hold that. To not say, you gotta settle down, but to say, I understand, I can see why you are so mad, because it is enraging when you see what's happening.
Thank you very much for coming. My question is, just with the growing latency of racism, what are your personal opinions of how POCs and also their allies can properly communicate the need to change the status quo when it's not as openly and readily apparent of the current racial tensions as it was during the time of Selma?
Excellent question. Is there another question we can group these together?
In some of my circles, when the expression "Black Lives Matter" is voiced, I hear other voices saying, "Well, police lives matter," and then the conversation stops. Pamela, it seems like your kind of response.
Yeah, I have one you. More. Thank you very much. You have another.
I have another.
There's plenty good room.
The other question I've been thinking about is, we're talking a lot about race, but what I am not hearing as much about is class, and I think that obviously those are so intertwined, and where does class fit into this fight?
What about class? Not just race, but class, and the ways in which class and race intersect, interact. I'll take one more while they see they're thinking. I have a little aside. You know, he mentioned black history. Not until the 60s, with the rise of black consciousness, did we really see African Americans and many marginalized people really become angry in public space. Sterling Brown says that down in Augusta, GA, I tell you the truth, they make niggas do their laughing in the telephone booth. We were not allowed to express emotion because emotion had something to do with humanity. And I'm not suggesting there were not people, there were slave revolts, people were angry and often violent. Well, however you want to name violence. But the main thing is that during the 60s, something happens with public space that provides opportunity to express this deep-seated rage, which our panelists have said is justified. I think it is justified, but I think it's a very dangerous, dangerous weapon. Rage is you ought to feel it if it's there, but I think it can be nitroglycerin walking across a tightrope. We've got to find ways to live with rage and not be destroyed by the rage. It's a critical question, and I don't think we have all of the answers to that. Three questions.
So, to the the reframing of the hashtag movement Black Lives Matter. It is a reframing. It is a reframing to the statement all lives matter, which is a continued microaggression against Black people. It is an erasure of the problem. Yeah, all lives matter, but all lives aren't being oppressed. All lives aren't being profiled, racially profiled, aren't being attacked systemically, aren't enduring systemic institutional racism. So to suggest that all lives matter is tantamount to the statement, which people still say, well, you know, I don't see color. That's similar. So we're insisting that the hashtag movement not be made subordinate, not be reduced to all lives matter, when we're at a point in our nation's history where we're looking at a Black man being choked to death on the streets of New York. You cannot reduce that to all lives matter. You cannot oversimplify it to all lives matter. These are Black men and women who are being killed, and we are insisting that it remain Black Lives Matter.
Dr. Messick.
These are profound questions that are being posed, and I'm reminded of how America is still so segregated, even in our integrated ways in America. Most of us still worship in churches that are highly segregated by a race, and most of our friendship circles tend to operate that way. If you're in the academic community, it's a little different, perhaps. But there's a
sometimes.
But still, we still do not have that kind of conversation with people. And then for the white community, we're often very isolated from the realities and really are not having the dialogue that would seem not only necessary, but imperative in our time. And despite the 24 hours news cycle, and despite all of the social media, we have a high degree of ignorance, in part, personally chosen, I suppose, on our part. But the white community still has not understood, and our leadership has not led us in ways to open up our minds in ways. But you know, how many white churches have really had a conversation on the subject? How many faculties? I don't know. But how many families really have that experience, unless they have really close ties?
No, I think Don has brought us back to where I started. And I keep on putting the church on the line. The church has to act. The church has to act. And the white church has to act like the church.
I do. I think the sister asked a question about the latency of racism. And I don't know that I want to agree that racism is latent.
Is what?
Latent.
Oh.
I don't know that I want to, you know, embrace that fully. I think it's shifted in how it's deployed. I think the way people deploy their racism may have shifted, may have become a little bit more sophisticated, but it's still there. And in some ways, it's even more apparent. I mean, you have but to go on the internet and read some of the comment sections of any blog, look at some of the trolling that takes place on Twitter, and you know that racism is anything but latent. It is, as my son calls it, people who are really become webcam gangsters. They come at you full throttle under the notion that they have some anonymity, that they can't be found out. So there are different resources that are being deployed. But I don't know that it's late night. I suppose that depends on what context you come from. I sort of like the movie. I see racists every day.
It's kind of like I see dead people. But I do want, just one moment, I do want to acknowledge something that I heard in your question. it has to do with this idea of a post-racial society as well. And a lot of that is given to us through media, but it also is a very, very dangerous, slippery slope, because race is the mark of the modern world. You cannot have the modern world without thinking of race. So it's so deeply ingrained in the very fabric of our society and our lives, it can appear as latent. But I think what Pamela is saying, that it is present, is really actual. But if we have language, covers a multitude of sins. And I think the instances with Barack Obama are a very good example, Don. There was a hand here, I only got one more round. This hand, and those two hands. Good.
I don't have a question. I just want to say something on the positive side. I went to girls' high school here in the city of Boston. I graduated in 1940. When I went to that school, I lived outside the city in Dorchester. And the first time we were gathered in the gym, I think it was, and we were all in a circle and we were asked to hold hands with the person next to me. And I looked and it was a black girl. That didn't bother me. Her name was Virginia Tabb. I remember it to this day. I held her hand. I became friends with many, many black girls. They supported me when I ran for the presidency of the Athletic Association. And my experience at the Boston Public School there was very positive. So even back in the 40s, there was some good things happening.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I'm interested in what you mean by latent.
Oh, well, I believe it's sort of miscommunicated on my behalf. It's more so the presumption of latency with the change of terminology and the way that in discussions of race, it's not so blatant in that there's, you know, signs that say colored only, whites only. So now that it's not as easy to perceive, people believe that racism is gone. And therefore, in trying to state that there is still a need to change, there aren't examples that one can just immediately grab and present that to others.
Very good example. I only have this hand here, and then Kristen, and then everybody, I must wrap it up because Ray has his finger on it.
I think just to bounce off of that point.
A little louder.
To bounce off of the point of latent, the comment about racism being latent, I think one of the issues being of the younger generation is that there is this narrative of history that the civil rights movement happened. The women's rights movement happened, and it's not still happening, and that social movements in the United States don't happen for, you know, 10 years. They happen for 50, they happen for 100. They're still happening now. So I think the question that I find difficult in speaking to people who are my age is how do we connect this to a larger movement, and how do we see this as a movement that's still happening, and how do we have that discussion?
And the issue of class was raised too, and also in this question.
It relates to this issue of class and privilege. And one of my concerns is, how do I manage complicity with racism? When we become part of institutions like this one, that even as prophetic as it claims to be, it provides a platform where we become complicit with this process that is make it, even in some cases in situations, it strengthens this racism that it permeates everything. How do we manage that?
I'm glad they're answering these.
Yeah.
Well, you know, Chris, I'll start with your question. Herein, again, is one of the reasons I went down to Ferguson. It is, and one of the reasons I went down is because I think it's important for us, for scholars of color, to be intimately connected with the culture and the communities from which we were raised and if that culture and community was not a community of color, that we do the work that's necessary to be connected with communities of color so that we can give back in some way. I love W.E.B. Du Bois' Souls of Black Folk. I love this idea of a talented tent. It's been part of how, in fact, I was raised. My parents didn't have an education, but they always insisted a bird can only fly so high and then it must land. And so even though I work in the academy, I'm intentional about staying connected to the community. And I realize even my intention to stay connected to the community is not always, I can't always act it out. Case in point, I went to Ferguson, they were having a conversation, a young brother, you know, they let the guys just have a conversation and have it, and they went on back and forth. And then when two sisters decided to have a conversation, they began to raise their voices, and a young black man stepped in the middle of the conversation and cut the sisters off. To which I responded, why did you cut the sisters off? You didn't cut the guys off. And one woman, one black woman in the group yelled out, and I will say, share the very words she said, oh, don't come down here with that feminist shit. And I recognized immediately that I hadn't checked my own privilege and within the community that I considered myself intimately aware of and connected with. There's still some growing that I have to do and able to give back to my people. So, you know, it's understanding your context and understanding who you are.
Picking up on where you said, I don't have quite the right language, but we have to recognize each in our own way whatever privilege we have in terms of where we stand, the cultural and class systems, and yet our calling to be liberators, liberating ourselves and others. Even as we benefit oftentimes from unjust systems, we have to seek to change those systems. And that's a challenge because most of us are living contradictions in some way or another. We may be against Wall Street, but we like our pension money. Whatever other things, we have to keep to push for change. And some degree of humility about where we stand in life in relation to others.
We have a closing comment.
Don mentioned earlier that he is more hopeful after meeting a number of the BU School of Theology students this afternoon. I want to just underscore that I too join him in that. We met with a group of students at lunch today, and the questions they raised, the responses they had, the concerns they had reminded me that this still is the school of the prophets. We met with Dean Moore's class this afternoon, and a wonderful group of students there who raised questions, who expressed themselves. And I'm just glad to see that BU still is on the cutting edge. So I'm hopeful too. Now, I just want to say one other thing, and I said this to the class as my last word to the class. Now, go out and practice what you have learned here at West's the School of the Prophets. I'm so used to talking to West's students. Go out and practice what you have learned here, and make the witness, and don't make us embarrassed that you went to Boston University and you're no longer a prophet.
Thank you all. Seminary singers are right next door, right?
Marsh Chapel.
Some of you remember where that is.
To me.
Good evening and welcome. Welcome to those among us who believe passionately that music can change the world.
Amen!
Because we know change must come.
That's right.
Welcome to those among us who marched in Selma and those who stood up in Ferguson.
Welcome.
Welcome to those among us who may have never pondered their privilege and those who are made painfully aware of its lack each day. Welcome to those who feel silenced and those who shout and sing from the mountaintops. Today, tonight is for you,
amen.
For all. We are so blessed to have in our midst a man of God who is living proof that music has the power to preach.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Thank you, Mark and the band, for coming and leading us tonight. And you will surely be blessed tonight by this choir of passionate human beings that desire to preach God's message of truth, inclusion, love, and peace through sacred song. So welcome. We hope that you'll sing and clap, that you'll stand up and sway, move your hands and your feet, and embody the truth that no matter what people say, we are all children of God.
Thank you.
This piece, it might be of some interest, but the words of this next anthem that the choir is going to sing were written for a nuclear disarmament conference, first heard in 1982 at the Riverside Church in New York City, Creation of Peace.
Build the land where the captives go free, where the oil of gladness is all on morning. We'll build. Iceland today, my friend, and I'll be facing difficulties today, tomorrow. I still have dreams.
I still have a dream.
It is a dream to be the roots of the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its dream.
When we allow freedom to ring, when we let it ring for everybody to
Power. Even when
will need your help at the end. So be ready to sing a verse. Lift every voice and sing.
Observe. Selma, where there is food, and if I get there, there might not be any food if I get there before you do it.